Hello everyone, welcome to a special Outlook Business webinar series titled Strat Talk, presented by Hyperlink Infosystem and co-sponsored by RR Solution. And the topic under discussion is realigning to the new normal. Today we have with us Mr. Rama Nagaram, a techie who now calls the shots at the Walmart-owned fashion e-tailer Myntra. Welcome, Mr. Nagaram, and thank you for taking time out from your busy schedule. Before we kind of deep dive into it, just wanted to know, you started off as in the tech side at Flipkart, and then you found yourself in the hot seat in 2019, and then you find in 2020 you are facing a once in a generational kind of a crisis. So how are you coping with that, both at a personal and a professional level?
Well, it's been a humbling experience. I've been with Flipkart Group for 8 years. I started as an engineering manager, where I was working on Flipkart's first digital product. For the first 5 years, I was purely on the technology front. But Flipkart being a startup and Flipkart being an organization where, you can do anything. You can actually sign up for things and you can do anything you can to the organization. So I found opportunities on the business side where I could contribute. That's how I got exposed to the business side of things. And before I knew, I was actually working with Flipkart Fashion as a tech partner. When the opportunity kind of came up in Myntra, I was chosen for the role. So yeah, it's a journey that I would have not imagined when I started with Flipkart. So it's been a fascinating journey. Last 1.5 year at Myntra, it's been, like I said, a humbling learning experience. The industry, the fashion industry, has been very, very welcoming. Over the last 18 months, built a lot of relationship with a lot of major brands across the globe. And what I'm trying to bring to the table is something the brands are looking forward to. And what I actually learned from the brands is something that's making me comfortable in the space of fashion. So it's been a really humbling and educating time so far.
So can you give us a sense of the environment? Just, you know, we were before the year started, how were things? I mean, you were just kind of settled into your role as a CEO and you just had your first end of reason sale, and then you have this COVID. So, and then you had this sudden shutdown, which you never imagined would have happened. So how did you kind of navigate through that initial period of shock? And how are you kind of, you know, realigning yourself to the new normal in some sense?
Sure. So I started with Myntra in January 2019. So it was a good 14 months before COVID hit us. And in those 14 months, what we have done as Myntra is, how can we reposition ourselves as an organization that can have a sustainable growth towards profitability? So we kind of questioned some of the fundamental ways of doing business. And looking back, those turned out to be the right investments because they are more relevant in a post-COVID world than ever. So some of those investments kind of carried forward into this this whole unlock 1.0 phase of the organization. But when the lockdown actually hit us, the first priority for us as an organization, which was it almost came naturally to us that Flipkart Group was the safety of our employees. We wanted to make sure all our employees, all our partners, and in a way our consumers as well, are safe. So we quickly had to scramble things to make sure all our employees are safe, all our partners are safe, and all the packages going out at that time, we had to reinvent the ways to make sure they are being delivered the safe way. And then we went into the lockdown phase where we were not operational. But the glad part is the organization embraced the new ways of working, which is working from home, much faster than anybody in the leadership team anticipated. In fact, the teams were much effective working from home, and that's how we were able to put that lockdown time into a much effective way of reimagining the organization. In fact, if you look at what Myntra has done in those 60 days of lockdown, we launched Myntra Studio, we launched Myntra Move, we launched content on the platform where we could understand what users are looking for during the lockdown time, which also gave us insights into the kind of selection we should be carrying going into Unlock 1.0. At the same time, we've also realized there was a much higher need for PPEs and masks. So we worked with all the brands across the country to launch masks on the platform. That's how we became operational, actually. And when the Unlock 1.0 started, we took all those data insights, turned into a selection assortment from all the brands. In fact, we worked with the brands to match what the users were looking for, and the brands were quick to iterate on our insights and come up with a selection. So this URS event that we just finished last month, it was a huge success because for the first time, the fashion industry sold what consumers were looking for than what we wanted to sell. And that was possible because of all the data and the tech investments we made in last 14 months, and especially in the last 2-3 months.
We'll just take a short break and continue with that. Yeah, you spoke of the fact that, you know, when you took over in January 2019, you kind of, you know, took a hard look at some of, you know, the way the business was run. And you said the decisions and some of the investments that were taken have really paid off. So can you give us a sense of, you know, what is it that you kind of did in that 1 year period prior to the COVID, when you said in terms of, you know, realigning some of the decisions and the way the business was run?
The health of any business can be measured from the inventory it holds. So we were actually looking at, we are a marketplace end of the day, and the inventory actually flows through us. So we need to relook at our business models where we were doing justice to the inventory that was flowing through our platform. The kind of visibility we gave to the inventory on our platform was directly related to the kind of sell-through that we could get on the platform. That is only possible if we understand our consumers very well. So a lot of investments were made to understand our consumers more at a granular level. And this required us to understand not just the consumer, but also the fashion world. See, the size is not the only criteria in the world of fashion. You and I could be wearing the same size, but you and I might not be wearing the same fit. So it had to go to that level of understanding. So we increased our investments into computer vision, understanding the fashion elements, and understanding the consumer. What we were able to achieve was a better understanding of our consumer, which became incredibly advantageous to us during the lockdown. During the lockdown, we were one of the first to realize that there will be need for work from home essentials. There will be need for loungewear. There will be need for comfort wear. There will be need for do-it-yourself masks, the face mask that comes as part of the beauty products. Do-it-yourself hair things, do-it-yourself skin kind of products. And we were quickly able to translate these insights to actionables for the brand partners, and they were able to get this selection. So if you think of it, the way the investments we looked at were, how do we understand the consumer more, and how do we translate these insights into actionable things for the brands to work on. And the second thing that we also worked on is on a consumer experience side. If you look at it, I'm not talking about consumer experience on the app side, it's a consumer experience when it comes to delivery of things. We looked at what are the ways we can augment the offline behavior, because most of our target segment was still buying from offline. So we looked at some of the fundamental things that were missing in the online space. For example, almost 2 in 3 jeans that were getting written on the platform was for longer length. Everything else was right, it's just a longer length. In an offline space, if you walk into any store, they would alter it for you. But as an online player, we were not doing it. So we were one of the first ones to introduce alteration at the doorstep. So you don't have to return it. We will actually alter it for you. We also tried the experience stores across all the tech parks where the consumers were having a problem. I mean, this is a place where you work and you probably cannot step out when our delivery agent is carrying the packet outside of your office. So we wanted to take away that kind of hassle, and we went with experience stores where the packet will be in your tech park experience store for 2 days, and it's up to you to actually pick it up. And when you're picking it up, it also has a dressing room where you can try it right then, right there. If you don't like it, you can return it. If it is about alteration, there is a tailor also in the experience store, you can do it. So There were a bunch of things that we looked at our business and we said, here are the reasons why people are not coming online and what can we do from the technology side, from the operation side to augment for the offline gaps. At the same time, we also looked at how we can partner with the offline stores more. In fact, one of the biggest paradigm shifts we did as an online business is it's no longer about online versus offline. The future is actually about online plus offline. It's actually both the parties coming together. So one of the major investments we did last year was omni-channel integration, where we started working with the lot of brand partners and the orders that we were taking, especially in cities like Bangalore, the orders were getting delivered directly from the stores. So it just takes away a lot of time and travel for the product, and it can actually reach you faster because it's coming from a store nearby. And guess what happened in Unlock 1.0? When we did the Yoris event, we had 400 stores participating in the event, and most of the stores actually made up for the loss because of the shutdown they experienced in first two months of lockdown. So some of these investments are already showing the benefits and validating that our strategy is in the right direction. And all of this is actually making us believe that e-commerce is probably the only business model that was always built for a post-COVID world.
Yeah. So that part that you said about the omni-channel, you know, and the kind of stores that kind of participated in this end of season sale, can you give us a sense of, you know, what was the key driver that you kind of focused on to, you know, ensure that this really played to your expectation, in the sense that in 2019 also you had the first end of season sale. So how was the feedback from that? And taking that, how were you kind of, you know, since this you are talking in a lockdown phase and coming out of it, where you are talking of demand destruction, job losses, you know, salaries being cut. So was that some kind of an relook into pricing, into, you know, categories, markets, and, you know, said that let's kind of, you know, ensure that the sale really works.
Sure. So first thing first, like I said, our top focus was the safety of our employees and the well-being of our employees, because that is the first thing that gave us confidence that our employees are well taken care. Now we can even think of doing an event of this size. In fact, when COVID hit us, we were in the middle of our appraisal cycle. When we went into shutdown, we were in the middle of calibrations, and there was this big question across the organization where what will happen to their appraisals, what will happen to their hikes, bonuses, promotions, and everything. We as an organization, we decided to go ahead with the appraisals as if COVID never happened. In fact, we just stuck to our ways of doing calibrations in terms of the hikes, promotions, bonuses. And that was one thing we just took off the everyone's list of problems. The second thing was the safety of our employees, where we made sure their well-being is taken care of. In fact, we're one of the organizations which started with all the online sessions for our employees. In fact, we were telling our employees to stay away from work. It's the other way. We were asking employees to please take some time off from work, do yoga, do meditation. We even had counseling sessions for parents with young kids, first-time parents, expecting parents. We even had a couple of employees who got married during COVID. So we gave all the kind of assistance. We had doctor on call. So whatever we could do for our employees, and we are still continuing to do it. The reason why I'm saying that this was the first and a very critical investment we as an organization did into our employee well-being. This kind of gave us the momentum to go into an event like this. And what we also experienced during the lockdown from the data on the platform, when we launched the content on the platform, we were getting users onto the platform. That gave us enough data to understand what users were looking for. So when we were trying to put together an event, this time we put together an event with a very clear view of selection in mind. This is what India is going to need in the lockdown, and the lockdown is not going to go away. The work from home is going to continue. So the event assortment should actually look differently from the previous one. Based on that, we took all kinds of bets and plans. So we communicated this to our brand partners, who were they did a fantastic job of getting the collection together in such a short time. and making this selection happen. The second thing was we did take a bet on tier 2, tier 3. Every time we did an event, tier 2, tier 3 participated very well. But this time, our bet was on the new customers we would be acquiring from tier 2, tier 3. Again, the reason is the tier 2, tier 3's access to premium products was the nearby metro tier 1 cities, which these guys used to travel once in a month or once in a 2 months. But with all the travel restrictions, that access has been cut down. So it became very obvious that Myntra would be the only choice for premium products. And whatever the apprehensions they had of shopping online would be overcome with this pandemic situation. So that's what we want to take it into advantage. So we also made selection much closer towards tier 2, tier 3 liking, which is more of ethnic wear, more of kids wear and all of it. So all of these bets kind of played out very well for us. If you look at just the consumer's perspective, 1 in 2 users came from tier 2, tier 3, or 1 in 2 orders came from tier 2, tier 3. But of all the tier 2, tier 3 users that came to the platform, 87% of them were new customers to the platform. So it played out in a very big way that we have finally penetrated into tier 2, tier 3, which was always a challenge for us as a premium platform. So that's one thing that happened. Second thing, the kind of selection bet we took was very well received by our consumers. In fact, we were out of stock in many categories during the event. That also played out very well. The third thing, the entire event was put together by our employees working from home, which was, if anybody told me this before COVID that we can do an event of this size working from home, I would have not believed it. But it kind of happened now. And the reason why I'm saying this is because of the empathy and compassion the organization had in the beginning for our employees. So all of these investments kind of came together and made this event happen for us.
We'll just take a short break and we'll be back.
RR Gifting. Gifting for memorable brands. Call now.
So in this, you spoke also of a lot of offline brands also participating in this sale. So was it like a inventory clearance? Obviously would have been one part of it. And how much did pricing really play for you to get that hook from that tier 2 and tier 3 towns? Was the pricing actually lower than the last year's end of season sale? Where was the bulk of the inventory kind of, you know, focused on, or the sale that was focused on?
As a marketplace, Keshav, we don't control the pricing. It's actually the brands that control the pricing for their consumers. So it would be hard for us to say at the platform level if the discounting was lower or higher. But what I can actually say is the COVID actually hit us in the middle of a spring summer season. So the kind of inventory that went on sale during the event was actually in season selection. It's not an old season selection. So the brands were also conscious about the kind of discounting they were doing. So, and the other side of the story is the demand was very well up there. It was a latent demand, but it was a pent-up demand that existed. So there was no need to do heavy discounting from the brand side as well. So what we did as a platform was we kind of brought the demand and the supply together in the most effective way from the geography, from the territories that the brands didn't have access to. So that's the role we played in.
Okay. So can you give us a sense of, what is the numbers in terms of order size? What was the average order size that you saw this time around vis-a-vis the last year for each categories? Was it higher? Was it lower?
The order size, I would say, was a little higher than last year. Not as much as the kind of the demand that we saw. The reason is the category mix changed this time. What was sold in the last event was occasion-led fashion, which usually comes with a high price tag. This time, it was more about loungewear, comfort wear, leisure wear, kids wear, which are lower price tag items. But it was kind of complemented by or augmented by the number of items they were putting into the basket. So in a way, the basket size remained the same, whereas the number of quantities the number of items in the basket went up significantly. So next night, the basket size was slightly above what it was last year. But what is exciting for us is the number of items the new consumers also purchased from Myntra. It was significantly, it was almost 2x of what a new customer was buying pre-COVID.
Okay. So as you said that you are looking at this, sort pushing this to this omni-channel strategy, but now that we clearly aren't yet out of the unlock phase, and we really don't really know how demand will eventually play out, and now we are stepping into, in some months, the fashion months, I mean the festival months. So how are you kind of talking to your brands? What's the kind of sense that you're getting speaking to some of these established brands in terms of demand, in terms of pricing? How are they viewing the whole
I think what COVID has done to our relationship with the brands is they are now more strategic than they were in the past. Together, we are looking at the demand. Together, we are actually coming up with the plans of what we should be holding, what we should be doing in terms of selection for these seasons, upcoming seasons. So this dialogue is making both the parties more effective. We are actually reacting to the demand rather than actually taking a supply into a market and expecting it to be picked up. So that's a very welcoming change in the world of fashion. If you actually take a macro view to this, this would eventually address the excess inventory the industry has always been dealing with. If we're able to actually scale it up, react to the demand as fast as we can and go to an on-demand manufacturing, fashion industry would be soon solving the problem that the industry has been dealing with for a very, very long time, the inventory problem. So that's what's happening. Now, coming to very specific next 2-3 months, what we are doing is not different from what we've been doing in last 2-3 months. We're taking our insights, taking to the brands, making sure our plans are in place, and making sure we get the right selection onto the platform. So the biggest focus as a retailer and the biggest focus for any brand right now is to understand the consumer more. And that's what's happening.
So the understanding is largely aimed at getting the pricing right, or is it just trying to...
selection changes, right?
Okay.
The kidswear is picking up traction. The beauty in beauty, the do-it-yourself kits are picking up traction. Home decor is picking up traction. Now that people are getting more time at home, they're finally doing their home. Fitness at home is picking up traction. Yoga mats, fitness wear, all of this is picking up traction. So we are actually passing all this interest ahead of time to the brands so that they can be ready with the selection. In terms of pricing, the brands are also conscious of the macroeconomic situation across the board and accordingly pricing the things. So I think brands are doing a brilliant job of keeping the supply at a much affordable value to the consumer.
So in your own case, how are you managing? So we have seen a lot of businesses like taking some very hard calls of slashing manpower, you know, curtailing hikes, and in some cases also taking some cuts at the top level and as well as at the mid-management level. So how are you kind of looking at this whole cost control and getting the efficiencies right in this particular phase?
Well, that's what I was talking about. Ever since I started with Myntra in January 2019, our focus was to take the organization towards a sustainable path towards profitability. And that also involves looking at the way we've been doing things in terms of our operations, in terms of all the OPEX that we've been having as an organization, and trying to look at what are all the efficiencies we can get from it. So that is continuing for us. It did not get quite impacted by COVID. Thankfully, like I said, e-commerce is one business model which was always which looks like it was always built for post-COVID. So we are doing phenomenally well in the post-COVID world. But that doesn't mean that we will lose the sight on our efficiency. We being a tech organization, we are actually throwing tech at the problem rather than heads at the problem. So that's what we are looking at. In terms of job cuts and all of it, fortunately, we don't have to do it. We were staffed the right way even before COVID, and that will continue to happen. We are one of the very few organizations in the country who are still hiring, because there are certain investments we are accelerating. Like Omni was one investment which got accelerated. Mintra Studio, which is a content platform, that is getting accelerated. In terms of the size and fit as an initiative, we are actually working on a tech solution, which again will require a lot of data sciences and engineering talent to come on board. So in terms of our hiring, our plans are going ahead. Our investments haven't stopped down. In fact, they've only become more intense, given there's a much bigger need for these investments to be productized as early or as soon as we can. In terms of efficiencies, what we have embarked on a year ago, they are still continuing. We're looking at ways to become a more efficient organization and a much effective in terms of what we deliver to our consumers.
So, being part of Flipkart, you know, that whole ecosystem of being part of a startup and now being part of Walmart, has there been any change in terms of approach, in terms of doing things, in terms of culture, people culture, work culture? Has there been any significant change that you have seen, or being part of two different, in say, entities?
No. Walmart has always given us the complete space to operate the way we've been doing. And Walmart has been clear from day one that there is a reason why Flipkart is Flipkart, because of its culture and because of how things have been doing. And the same thing applies to Mintra as well. Mintra's culture is unique, and Mintra, and I'm one of those very few lucky ones who have experienced Flipkart culture and Mintra culture, and both have their own uniqueness in terms of the culture and the values they bring to the table. While the values, the underlying core values are the same, the way they get manifested in the organization are very unique to what these two organizations do. And we're very clear that the last thing we want to touch is anything that is already working for the organization. What Walmart brought to us as a business is a more systemic and sustainable way of looking at problem statements. And in fact, the journey that I was talking about, how do we become a more sustainable, profitable organization? It's not a direction we take from Walmart, but ever since we embarked on it, Walmart has been supporting us a lot, because they've been there, done that, seen that they have all the experience in the world to help us guide through the right thing. So it's a huge advantage for us at the Flipkart Group to always rely on Walmart for any help or any guidance. In terms of the recent changes we've done, we've realized that Tier 2, Tier 3 is going to be a big market for us. And the only thing that can limit us from growing in Tier 2, Tier 3 is our inability to penetrate these field codes. And during the lockdown, we decided that let's leverage Flipkart eCart, which has already been very strong in Tier 2, Tier 3. And right before the event, we were already working with eCart, and the kind of demand we saw from Tier 2, Tier 3 in the event, it would have not been possible if it wasn't for Flipkart eCart. So we are looking at the synergies across the group and even with the Walmart group, wherever we can. And there is a high-level commitment all the way from Walmart board to us. Wherever we need help, they're willing to help us navigate through the current times and current challenges.
So like you're saying that Mintra, like you, it's more like a marketplace, but is that also a conscious strategy that you would also be looking at private labels becoming a core part of the way you will grow in future?
Yes, that's true. I'll actually give you the context on why we went down the path of private labels. When we started looking at all the consumer data, when we started looking at all the fashion consumption in the country, we are a digital first company, so we were quickly able to identify the white spaces in the market, which were not addressed by any existing brands. By any existing established brands, let me put it that way, because Mintra is always a premium platform. That's when we decided that we could serve the space better if nobody else is serving the space. And that's how these brands actually came into existence. with all the expertise we have built in the world of fashion and with the right kind of tech investments we've been doing into this, we were able to actually work on these brands which are addressing a very specific white space in the market. And that is the reason why these brands have grown significantly in last 3-4 years, because of the right kind of the tech investment and the right kind of consumer product match that we were able to do on the platform.
Can you give us a sense of what's the contribution right now from the private labels, and also give us a sense of how did this whole year, the just concluded financial year, ended at what levels of top line?
Well, I'm sorry, I cannot give the exact numbers, but all I can say is it's contributing significantly to the selection that we carry. In fact, if you look at the URS selection, the platform was carrying 700 to 750,000 styles, out of which 150,000 styles came from in-house brands. So you can imagine the kind of share the in-house brands have in terms of the selection and the assortment we give to the consumers. And the fresh season and the in-style season is where the in-house brands do a fantastic job, because we do more of the insight-led design, and we try to keep it very, very reactive to what's happening in the world of fashion. So most of the selection that you see from our in-house brands are very trendy and very in-season selection.
Okay, and is there a particular pricing strategy that you follow with your private labels?
That's the white pricing that we talked about, and it comes with a pricing strategy. So we start with that as an input. We looked at the entire gamut of the fashion space in the country in each category, and we looked at the white spaces, and then we asked ourselves, can we do something qualitatively in this space that is available in the market? So it's the pricing comes with it.
So what's the range like, the private labels that you tend to?
We have very premium level products also in ethnic wear. If you look at House of Pathodi, they are very premium. They also have a starting range from 1200. We have a 10,000 rupee sherwani to a 1200 rupee kurta. So wherever the white spaces are, we address the white space. Same with HRX. We have the HRX gear going from 999 all the way to 3999. Wherever the spaces are, we are addressing the space.
Okay, okay. So going ahead, how do you look for FY21 is going to look like? I mean, we have already seen quite everyone saying that FY21 is a complete washout for most manufacturing, but for you as an fashion retailer, is that going to be the case, or will you end up at the same number or maybe higher? Because since you already had an end of recent sale, and what categories do you see where more demand could come in? Can you give us a sense of that?
Sure. End of season sale was always on the calendar, by the way. We just decided to go ahead with the calendar instead of actually disturbing it. In terms of our plans, this year will plan differently from the plans we had pre-COVID, especially from the kind of the categories and the selection that we will be having on the platform compared to what we were planning to have pre-COVID. But in terms of business, we are very optimistic about how this COVID is going to get more and more consumers towards e-commerce. And our investments towards making offline and online come together will also help us to become a very strategic player for the brand in months to come and years to come. So in a way, this year is going to be that the changing point for fashion e-commerce in the country for sure.
So can you give us a sense of how many established brands are there on the platform now, and are you seeing more and more newer brands trying to partner with you, given the environment that we are in, that most of them cannot open their shops and they are not very clear on, you know, which way footfalls, how the footfalls will eventually turn out to be? So can you give us a sense of some of...
Sure. Pre-COVID, we had a little over 3,000 brands on the platform. out of which 200 were global and Indian leading brands. Just in last 2-3 months, we have onboarded close to 60 new brands, and most of these conversations, most of these conversations happened starting from the brand side.
Okay.
This is a big welcoming thing for us as a fashion e-commerce player, where now the brands have realized that they need to be associated with a digital player. And what is also making this relationship stronger is our willingness to help them technologically. So we are becoming a fashion tech player for them. This omni-channel integration is something that would enable their stores also do very well in these constrained world. So that's how this whole relationship is changing. And the dialogue with the brands these days is at a very strategic level rather than at a transactional level. And that is very, very important for us, for the industry as well, to survive this pandemic.
Okay. So we have seen quite a bit of boutique, online retailers kind of struggle now that because of COVID and they are saddled with inventory and also. Do you see the possibility of some kind of consolidations, or would Myntra look at an interesting acquisitions, or in fact, did you get any such proposals on your table where there are online retailers who would like to get sold out?
Well, the proposals always came our way, and the lens we always applied to these proposals is, how is this going to help our vision? How is this going to help our mission towards profitability? And that hasn't changed because of COVID. Like I said, our focus in the post-COVID world or post lockdown has been to understand the consumer and make sure we get the right kind of selection and assortment and experience for our consumers. So anything that can come together with us to make this the mission statement stronger, we are open to it.
Okay. So, but any conversations going on as of now, or nothing else?
We do have a couple of fashion tech players that we are talking to, who've been working on AR, VR technologies, okay, especially with fitting room becoming a safety apprehension. We are looking at AR, VR ways of the digital trial. So we're looking at some players, and we are in active conversations with these players.
Okay. And in terms of dry powder, capital that's needed for, are you sufficiently funded, well capitalized for the next couple of years, or do you need more money coming in from the parent?
We are very well positioned with respect to capital, we are all set towards going towards an IPO.
Okay, by when can we expect that IP?
We will be letting the world know very, very soon.
Okay. So that, just before we kind of wrap this up, this you're saying that the journey towards profitability. So how soon is it, FY21, FY22, when are we going to see that run towards profitability?
It definitely got expedited because of COVID. We will be touching that milestone sooner than we had in the plan. But we will soon be telling, actually we will be telling the world when we become profitable. Trust me, that will be big news.
I have just two questions from the audience. One is from Harni Loza, is the founder and CEO of Hyperlink Infosystem. His question is that, is this the moment, the turning point for mobile first strategy to gain momentum now that, you know, businesses have been hit? So wanted a view on that.
The mobile first strategy happened in 2016, and Myntra and Flipkart were the first ones to do it. And that's one of the reasons why we enjoy the leadership today in mobile commerce. We're already in it.
So, no, I'm saying that is for them, they are just asking that, is that now the turning point, especially now that we are talking of a pre-COVID kind of an scenario?
In terms of consumers, the mobile commerce, turning point for mobile commerce, yes, it's definitely going to be a much bigger one. In terms of what, there will be more users coming onto the platform. There will be more geographies coming onto the platform for sure. So that's definitely a turning point.
And there's one more from Mr. Mukul Vashish. He's the director of RR Solutions. His question is, what strategies do you think businesses should adopt to manage overhead costs of ensuring employee safety and well-being as the economy eventually opens up for business? How do companies kind of
think? This is what I said in the beginning also, right? In terms of being empathetic and being compassionate, this is the time to be. And for us as an organization, we made sure we put employee safety at the center of everything. And we made sure their well-being is also our priority for us. And this turned out to be, like I said, the ERS event would have not been possible if it wasn't for the kind of investment we made into our employees. So my answer is that this is the time we need to come together as an organization, and the rest will fall in place.
Okay, thanks a lot, Amar, for that interesting session with Outlook Business, and hope to be in touch with you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.